Now let me prophesy this to us. For the Lord says, some of you have tried everything you know to do to advance. And some of you have grown weary. This is in my message today. Some of you have grown weary in your running. But I say to you, the legal structure and the order that you have been in the past will not bring you into the freedom of your future. I say to you, and this is what the 700 means. I say to you, I will complete what needs to be completed. And if you will stop now and hear my word and let me secure your rest. Now hear what I'm saying to you. It's the rest from striving. If you will let me secure your rest, I will refresh you, and I will restore you, and I will secure your future. Let's thank God for that. Wow. Well, it's really interesting, and I want to do something. Dancers, bring the river back out here. Terry, you and Bob, we're going to stretch the river out. And we're going to pour this offering in the river. And we're just going to leave it stretched out up here. Because I think what wears us down is mammon. Just hold your offering. You're going to put it right in the river. You're going to be the first one. Wait a minute. Just hold it. You're going to be the first one to put it in the river. Just lay it down on the floor. I think the world around us wears us out. And that's what it's meant to do. The Bible says that about you. The world is an enemy of yours. Now let's pour this offering down here on this river. Tina, you and this young man here. Penny, you and Marcus, let's lay our offering down. Alice Pockris, we love you. Amen. And I think that we don't understand the multiplication structure that God has for us. I've been studying something, which I'm not speaking on today, but I've been studying it. And it's the power of forgiveness. And see, in the power of forgiveness, when you go back into how Jesus taught forgiveness, you have to go back into the priesthood in Leviticus to learn it. And I remember Pam would always read through her Bible till she got to Leviticus, and she'd say, oh my gosh, that's got too much in it and too many laws. And I said, just skip it and go to something else. One day you'll come back to it. But I've been reading Leviticus, and in the midst of it, you see everything Jesus taught in Leviticus. And you see about why he taught, don't bring your gift to the altar if you have aught against somebody. And what's happening right now, people have to prosper. Tell somebody you've got to prosper. And we've got to break into a new prosperity, people. I'm telling you, we can't. And listen, we pay bills all week long for people just to keep them moving. And we're supposed to. It's part of what you need to do is give mercy. That's part of your freedom. And some of you, if you didn't give here, you would never freely give mercy to others. You're just not made that way. And so we're helping people all week long make their way forward. And in the midst of it, what you have to understand is, but there comes a time where you have to break forth into a new pool of prosperity. Tell somebody today, my new pool is breaking forth. Amen. Now, let me teach what God's saying to me today. Janice came to me and said, when I read that email, that's got three distinct messages in it. And I said, I read it this morning. I got up at 12, from 12 to 2. Norma Sarvis from Israel wrote me and said, why are you up or so early? And I was seeking the Lord on our behalf. And I said, Lord, that's got three or four messages in it. And I said, just show me what to say to us today that you're saying to us. And so I got here. Pam even got up early. I thought, my God, we're having revival in the house. I am telling you. Because I'm telling you, not a lot has changed since we started having kids. I mean, we started having these kids. Our house was a showplace, perfect. We started having kids. I didn't have a place to sit. I didn't have a place to stay. My only resource was to travel the world. It was my home. And nothing's changed much. Now we've got all the grandkids, and now we've got all the dogs and now Isaac's dog has decided, since Isaac was gone twice, that he has adopted me as his companion. And so, you should see me. I barely fit in the chair Anita got for me from the secondhand place. And then this dog gets in and roots me over so he can have the major part. And then I had to take back the chair that we got for our anniversary because Maggie didn't have any place to get in. And Maggie's a big dog, so when it didn't have an ottoman, so she would just crawl up in my lap. I said, this is not going to work. So Anita went and found us one that had an ottoman. What I'm saying to you is, once you start having revival, you have to keep moving. You can't get comfortable. Now, hear what I'm saying to you. That's what's wrong with a bunch of you. You're trying to get comfortable, and God's on the move. Tell Aslan's on the move. Tell somebody. Now, remember, let me show you something that's happening here. Let me show you. Wait a minute. We want to see that video first before I speak. Let me show you our latest increase.
The first time.
Now turn to somebody and say, you need to get happy. You need to let somebody else occupy your space and get happy. Let's thank God for that double portion. Isn't that awesome? Isn't that awesome that in a year that God says this is the year of the camel, you have people out here who have been saving their money. So all along through the years, so they could give it to the Lord so we could experience a camel. Let's thank God for those who gave for those two camels. Now, go ahead, Brian. We're in a season from recovery where we're moving from recovery to wholeness. Now, some of you need to catch up. You need to get in recovery so you can be made whole. Tell somebody, I gotta keep moving. Now, so when I was seeking the Lord, he asked me three questions. And I believe these questions were for each one of us in here. He said, now, if you're preparing to cross the bridge into your future, I want you to answer these three questions for me. Number one, will you go through your narrow place? Now, you're going to have to answer these. Will you go through the narrow place that I ordain for you? See, Ann just went to Canada with me. I've watched Ann, I've watched Bob McGregor, I've watched others go through their narrow place this year. I've watched Keith with a surgery, Lee, others. Many of you are coming up to a place and you're saying, this time I'm not going to look at this the same way. I'm going to back up, let God fill me with faith, and I'm coming through. Second question, will you keep building and not let the enemy get the upper hand? See, to build means you're adding to so that someone in the future can see what you were about. Will you keep building? See, most of us just live in the moment. And we don't ever try to establish ourselves for the next season. And why I think the Lord loved the widow who had one little mite was because that was her future and she gave it. See? And so you have to say, well, I keep building and not let the enemy get the upper hand in me. And then the third question, we're going to answer these today. Can you believe the Lord that he can perfect that which concerns you? Do you really believe he can perfect? Now, the word perfect, God is perfect. That's really not what this word's about. Can he perfect means can he complete and finish what he assigned you to work out? Now I'm going to say it again. Can he complete and finish what he assigned you to work out on his behalf? Tell someone, ask someone this question, are you still working it out? Now ask them this question, do you think he's working it out with you? See, a lot of people think they're just working it out. And a lot of people, they are just working it out. But you have to say now, Lord, can you complete and finish that which concerns me? The other morning I got up and I was praying. And I was praying for an hour, especially after I got off that boat. And in the midst of it, Barbara made it to the end of the boat. Now, Robert and Linda's on a boat right now. Now, that wasn't my assignment. My assignment was to be with the Chinese, get off at the first port, and move on. And since then, I've already been to Canada. I've done all sorts of things since then. And so, Barbara and Dale, I felt like the boat was in good hands. And yet, you have to say, so I was seeking the Lord the next morning after I got home because we had to turn right around for the trip to Canada. And I was telling the Lord my anxieties. Does anybody else have any anxieties? Please, somebody raise their hand. Now, I was telling the Lord my anxieties, and he said these words to me, I can perfect what concerns you. But when he said that, it was as if I had to very specifically outline my concerns. Now, I want you to hold on to that. And something happened in me because I wasn't fretting on my knees any longer. Does anybody else ever do that? Fret before the Lord about everything you need and everything you want and everything you're not seeing and everything that should happen. And no longer I was fretting. I was actually telling the Lord what he needed to know that was concerning me. And it was only four things. I mean, before that, I was just going off with the Lord. But then once I got real focused, it was only four things that concerned me. Now here's the second thing. This, and I'm going to just go through this quickly because I'm listening to people and I'm not sure they're getting the moment that God's speaking. This is the year of the kinsman redeemer. That means someone who has authority to buy back what you need bought back. That's what it means. And he's revealing himself. And this is what the Lord said to me. And that's all I'm going to do today is tell you what the Lord said. You can write it down. And then if you don't do it, I'm not accountable for it. Because that's what the Bible says. And I don't have to fret any longer over all of you. See? He said this to me. He said, some aren't asking me to buy back anything. Write it down. Because if it's a year for him to buy back something you've lost, and you're not asking him to buy it back, you're going to miss your moment. Does that make sense? And if there's something that you know you let go of that you shouldn't have had to let go of, but you had to let go of it. You had to. There was no other way out for you. You had to let go of it. You need to say, this year I'm going to watch to see how you return that. Now, here's something else. At every conflicting crossroads season, God looks at us and says, covenant is important. Who are you aligned with? Who's aligned with you? I mean, that was the only reason we had this boat trip was because there were 20 key Chinese leaders that said, we don't want to go forward without spiritually being aligned right. And these were people who had government influence, business influence, spiritual influence, somewhere in the Communist Party. Because the Communist Party isn't what we think in our mind. Because in the midst of any civil government party, you're still going to have to recognize the government of God. You're going to have to recognize something greater than what is ruling in the earth realm. See? And you have to say, Lord, part of my faith getting unlocked is understanding authority. No greater faith have I seen in all of Israel than the one who understood authority, who knew who was ruling what. See, that is so key in your life. Who's ruling what in your sphere of authority? And if you'll understand that and learn to Pray for those. You're to pray for everyone in authority over your life. You will never get set free. You will never have what you need without learning to pray for authorities. So you have to say, now, Lord, in this year of alignment, where am I aligned? Now, here's something else. It's a year of Goliaths. Do you know what that really means to you? There will be 40-day periods in your life where the enemy tries to convince you you can't move forward. That's what it means. That the enemy will come to you and try to develop your thought process in such a way so you think that you can't triumph in what you're trying to break through into. And because it's a year of Goliath, you have to understand, how am I going to break the power of that voice that's speaking into my life that is keeping me from moving forward? Here's the next thing. There's a growing opposition against multiplication. The enemy knows we are on the verge of transference of wealth. The enemy knows that God's people are being repositioned so they can prosper in new ways. The enemy knows that you have the ability. You saw it demonstrated today. This is why I wouldn't do it. To create something that didn't exist. That sound didn't exist. That sound wasn't on the list. The enemy knows you have the ability to create that. The enemy knows that I could see God's anointing on Tobias and call him up here. And know that he would do whatever God asked him to do. See, that's what threatens the enemy. Just us coming to church doesn't threaten him. It's just another hour in the day for him. But when we come and we gather, and all of a sudden God points out that we're gathering and the enemy sees that you're gathering, there's nothing that you won't need that he hasn't already supplied for. See, this is what we're pressing past. And I see people so stubbornly resisting what God has for them. And what they're resisting is multiplication. Now, here's the next thing. See, when we're transitioning and we're ending one season and moving into a new season, our new beginning, always there's going to be these three wars for us. We're going to war over poverty. Go ahead, Brian. Mammon rises up and says, wait a minute. I'm going to stop you from getting what you need to succeed in the next season. Wednesday night, we were talking about how someone had had a whole redo. We were at the bowling alley, and we were talking about how this one person had been redone in their life, and when they start back bowling, they can't even use the same equipment they've had in the past. And it is the same principle with each one of us. When you go through that transformation God is bringing you through in your identity, you're not using the same weapons you were using. See, that's the Goliath principle again. David couldn't use Saul's weapons to take out Goliath. David had to pick up a rock, five small rocks, and choose one of the small rocks and target that target and say, one small little word will fail you. Here's the next thing. There's a war with infirmity. And here's what I want you to know about infirmity. Infirmity is just not sickness, because infirmity has a handshake. It will shake hands with your trauma from your past season to try to keep you from moving into your next season. And it's going to find what you were traumatized into to keep you from advancing. So see, the minute, and we all have infirmity. I was sick for 3 weeks. When infirmity starts coming near you, you need to start resisting. And you can't give in to it one moment. It never, and never let someone teach you this. I wish we could never get sick, but we're in a world that's polluted. So in the midst of that polluted world, we go through things. It's part of the fall. But the moment you feel something attaching or getting into your body, you have to start resisting it. And let me tell you something. People said, well, I think they're going to die. It's no need praying for them. You pray for somebody until they take their last breath, and you're a part of them going into glory. You resisting on their behalf when they're taking their last breath, they throw a mantle on you, and you take that mantle, and everything they couldn't complete, you take it forward and complete it. And then here's the third thing. Religion will drown you. Now hear me. Religion will convince you, because you made some bad choices in your past season, that there is no path for you in the future. Religion will convince you to come and just sit quietly and hope that maybe the Lord will see that you're sitting somewhere on His behalf. Religion will convince you never to move forward and express God moving in your life. Religion will convince you to hang on to the last structure of glory and victory and never move forward and redo what needs to be redone. Never agree with religion. Now here's the next thing. Remember, this is the year of the camel. That's why we showed that. Gimel. It means we're going to start and we're going to mature into the new. Now hear what I'm saying to you. We're going to mature into the new. Some of you, see what happens with an individual, they'll get wounded in the eighth grade and they'll stay in the eighth grade. When they're 48, they're still in the eighth grade. Because the enemy compartmentalizes them with that wounding so that that part of their personality can't mature into this season. And that's why you see certain grown men acting like fools, because they never dated the girl of their dreams, therefore they'll look at her on the computer. Get my drift? Or you'll see someone who got hurt by one word and they are hanging on to that and they can't mature past that into freedom. The only way you can mature is through forgiveness. And then God starts unlocking something for you to be reintegrated into what you're supposed to be reintegrated into. Some of us have hard times. See, some of us can never quit doing something we know God has told us to quit doing because we won't let go of the moment when we started doing it. Does that make sense to you? So you're going to have to go back and let go of the moment when you started doing it and let Him take you through the process of maturing. Everybody say the word process. Because I think a lot of people are afraid to let go of it because they know they're going to fall and mess up in it. Now, hear what I'm saying to you. Therefore, they won't ever let go and go through a maturing process. The way the normal Christian life works, you're going to go back and you're going to let go of the situation, but you're going to have to grow up in it, and growing up is a process. You get my drift? It ain't going to happen overnight, people. You're not going to get out of your mess many times overnight. But once you start getting out of your mess, what did the Lord tell the woman who was caught in adultery? Go and sin no more. Just resist that and keep maturing and keep going forward as you move forward. And so what does this mean about the camel? Go ahead, Brian. It means you've got to find your way through, in Luke 18:25, this new narrow place. You've got to be unpacked. You've got to be repacked. And get yourself through and into a new place. Say it out loud. I'm going through. And unless you go through the narrow place, you can't get to the end of the thing that God's trying to get you to. And the narrow place can be a long way. It can be a short moment. But what you have to determine is, I'm going to go through it. Say it out loud. I'm going to go through it. Now, here's the last three things I want to say. You want to make your way through transition, which is the narrow place. And you want to finish strong. Now, hear these words. Tell somebody, I'm going to finish strong. Tell somebody, I'm going to keep building. I'm going to keep maturing. I've started something new and fresh in me, and I'm not going to stop. I'm not going to agree with an old pattern that I was agreed with. I'm not going to go backwards into a place that I used to be in. I'm not going to be held captive by that which is trying to hold me captive. I'm coming through. I'm going through. And look at somebody and say, I'm going to keep going. And remember last time when I was speaking, I was preaching. I mean, you know, that preaching anointing comes on you. And it was like God didn't say this to me that way. He said, I want you and I to really dialogue over this. So you decide to keep going, and you decide that I can and that I am quite able of getting you to the place that I have for you. Amen. See, here's several things to remember when it's time to start going. First of all, number one, don't attempt to go a way that you're not supposed to be going. Because remember Balaam? There's going to be an angel at your narrow place, and it's going to knock you off the donkey you're riding on. Matter of fact, not only is it going to knock you off the donkey, then the donkey's going to turn around because you're such an that the donkey is going to tell you what you need to know. Because you couldn't even hear it any other way. And it's sad when a donkey has to speak to you. You better come up with something. It is sad when the only voice you can hear is a donkey's voice. Now, I'm going to say it a different way. No, I'm going to say this one. Because since it's in the Bible, the word ass. I was at the bowling alley one day and someone was using all these words. I said, listen, there's three words you can use. They're all in the Bible. Ass, and I told him the other two. And I said, don't use the other words around Carol while we're here on this bowling lane. If it only can take an ass to speak to you to get you to your new place, you in a bad shape. Turn to somebody and say, I'm going to choose to hear the Lord. And remember, Paul got knocked off his horse. Turn to somebody and say, you can get knocked off that high horse you're on too. Second thing, you're going to have to receive that Issachar anointing. The people of Issachar, they knew the times, they knew the seasons. Before I went to bed last night, Pam started talking about St. Patrick's Day. I got up at 12:30 this morning and changed my whole outfit. She wondered, what in the world is he doing in there in the closet in the middle of the night? I said, I'm not dressed in time. See what I mean? You can be dressed for a wrong season, people. You got to get dressed in time. Now, I wish Robert, one thing I want to do, Brian and Ben, I want to play Robert's message on St. Patrick all week long so you can hear it, because there's nobody that understands St. Patrick. He had great implication to our future. So you want to understand the Issachar anointing. What does that mean? You want to understand the moment. Here's the third thing. You don't want to grow weary in the battle. And the enemy will wear you down. But that's why you go to somebody and say, listen, I'm getting weary in this thing. You need to get my arms up. You need to stand and watch for me. What was Shara's dream? Because I got to lay down and take a nap. Nothing wrong with that. Sometimes you have to rest so you can move forward. Here's the next thing. You have to get to the end of one season so you can get into the next level of anointing for the next season. Elijah, Elisha. You've got to be able to move forward like that. You've got to be able to recover something in your life. That's why I don't want you to miss a year of redemption so you can speak your testimony. Because, see, if you miss this year, the enemy has you captured for the years ahead. Because what does the Bible say the testimony does? It overcomes the devil. That's why the enemy doesn't want you to recover anything, because he knows if you recover one thing you got lost in the last season, you're going to use it against him. And he's going to have to pay you back twice. He's going to have to pay you back four times, or he's going to have to pay you back seven times of what you lost. That's why he doesn't want you to recover anything. And then some of you say, I don't even know how to get started. Think about the woman. She was a Gentile. Jesus came in, and she went up to him, and she said, heal my daughter. And he said, listen, I'm here for the Jews. You're a Gentile, and I love what this woman did. She looked at Messiah himself and said, I'll take the crumb you dropped down on the floor. You don't even have to treat me like a Jew. You drop a few crumbs, I'll pick them up, and I know from the crumbs my daughter can be healed. Some of you just need to bend over, pick up a few crumbs, and say, I'll start eating this and move on. Now, Brian, go to this. This is what I want to end. Remember what he said. Do you really think I can perfect what concerns you? Turn with me to Psalms 138 and let me read this to you. Quit being afraid to start a new process in your life. I love that woman. She had no right to even be at the table. And instead of leaving the table, she said, let me at least get the crumbs you've dropped off. I will praise you with my whole heart. Before the gods, I will sing praises to you. Do you know what that means? Before the demon rulers around me, I'm going to sing praises to you because you are a God above all other gods. I will worship toward your holy temple. I will praise your name for your loving kindness and your truth, for you have magnified your word above your name. See, that's why the word, the sound is so important. In the day when I cried out, you answered me. Just give him a cry right now. Now listen to this. You made me bold with strength in my soul. Lay your hand on somebody and say he's going to do a supernatural work in your soul this week. All the kings of the earth shall praise you, O Lord. Lord, we loose that to our president. When they hear the words of your mouth, we say he will hear you say something. He might be going to the toilet and he's going to hear you say something this week. Yes, they shall sing of the ways of the Lord, for great is the glory of the Lord. Though the Lord on high is on high, yet he regards the lowly, but the proud he knows from afar. Now here's what I want you to get. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you will revive me. Tell somebody, I'm going to be revived this week. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you will revive me. You will stretch out your hand against my enemies. Your right hand will save me. Now listen at this verse. The Lord will perfect, complete, finish what concerns me. Now, either the word's true or it's false. I want you to stand up. While you're standing up, I want you to tell the Lord whether you believe that word or not. He knows. He knows. And if you don't believe it, it would be wise to pretend and speak it with your mouth. You will perfect that which concerns me. You say it enough, before long you're going to say, wait a minute, maybe I do believe that. Maybe I do believe that thing that's been running me crazy, that I've lost hope in, maybe I believe that God really can perfect that which concerns me. Maybe he can take a chisel and a hammer and begin to chisel the hard places away. Maybe he can break the hard ground. Maybe he can transform me. Maybe he can fix that one kid that is running me crazy. Maybe he can unlock new finances. Maybe he can perfect what concerns me. Tell somebody he can perfect it. Tell somebody he can work it out. Now, with your standing, here's the things you want him to perfect. You want him to perfect your regrets from the past. Say it, perfect them, Lord, perfect them. You want him to perfect the insecurity that keeps you from boldly saying what you need to say. Say, perfect my insecurity. You want him to perfect that rejection strategy that hell has circled around you, where you set yourself up to be rejected because you feel rejected. Right now, just say, I want this thing perfected. You want him to perfect your selfishness where everything is about you. The first thing in every process is what's in it for me. And then finally, you want him to... Sarah had no idea this is what God said this week to me. He said, I will perfect that mind-tiring legalism which is trying to wear you down and stop you from completing what I assigned you to complete. God says, I can perfect that which concerns you. Let's give a shout. It might be a relationship that you need. It might be a new job you need. It might be seeing a breakthrough in a place you need to see a breakthrough. He can perfect that which concerns you. It might be a disease that you're trying to kill and you say, Lord, is this the end? And he can say, I'm perfect that which concerns you. Disease is not too tough for me. I know the perfecting power of why you're walking through this. I can perfect that which concerns you. Lay your hand on somebody, say, he's perfecting you. Some of you are tired from trying to be holy. That will wear you out. Put your hand on somebody and say, he can perfect. He can make you perfect. Now, Father, these next 2 weeks, now hear me carefully. We want you to do something new in us. We want you to get us back moving in a way we've never moved before. We want you to fully bring that last season to an end. We want you to perfect us as we go in to the season and begin. Now, this Tuesday at 3 a.m. will be our last prayer meeting at 3 a.m. on Tuesday. This Thursday for a month will be our last prayer meeting before Passover on Thursday. The week of Passover, we will start at 6 p.m. on Tuesday night and go 24 hours to 6 p.m. on Wednesday night. Then we'll have a worship service. And the Lord spoke to me and said, in this process of you praising me, I'm going to come down and start perfecting. Now, Father, if there's anyone here today that have never started this process where they've looked at you and said, Lord, I can't do this any longer. You've got to do it. If you're listening on the web, if you're here in this place, just wave your hand. Just say, Lord, I can't do this anymore. Hands going up everywhere. Lord, some hands going up. They've tried. They love you, Lord, but they can't make it through this hard place. Lord, I ask you, you said you will stretch out your hand against their enemy. I want you to quote this verse in as many different translations as you can quote it. Read it out loud, and then every time, yesterday the enemy would lambast me, and all I could do was quote this verse right back in his face. Hear what I'm saying to you. We are headed in to a perfecting, and that doesn't mean we become lily pure whites. It means he molds you for your future. He prepares you to advance. He overtakes what's trying to stop you. He gives you the energy to start a new race when one ends. Lord, we come right now. Let's just lift our hands before him. And we say, Lord, perfect that which concerns us. Now, I can't let us go until I say, be specific with him. That which is concerning you. And then say, Lord, let's work it out. Say that out loud. Lord, let's work it out. Work with me, Lord. Say it out loud. And he says, I can perfect that which concerns you. Let's clap our hands.